What you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. What you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself, and what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. Great Dawning, Grand Rising, Cleveland, Ohio. Vince Robinson here on 360 Info Network. We are waiting for our host, Antonio, to dial in, and we're also expecting a call from Wayne B. Chandler. He's going to be our very special guest right here on AM 1490 WERE. And also, we're going to do a very special broadcast today on Facebook, or actually it's going to be on Zoom. We're going to be switching over to the Zoom channel. I'll be putting in a link so that you can access it and you can get on and get your question on. But most importantly, you can listen, because we're going to be talking about something that's very important to know as we navigate the new horizon we've been traveling lately. It is absolutely a pleasure to be with you this morning. You know, it's a little cool out there. We had a heat wave earlier in the week, but now things are settling back into a new normal, so to speak. But hey, you know, we will get through this day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute. You know, there is so much going on in this country right now, and some of it needs to be talked about. You know, right now we're dealing with what happened in Minneapolis the other day, and it is just amazing that after all this time, we're still dealing with the same kind of violence towards citizens in our country. It just makes no sense that lives could be taken so senselessly. But, you know, there's always two sides to the story, and it is important for us to fully understand everything that's going on. So we're going to get into some discussion about that, but we're also going to talk about personal finance, because there's going to be a radical change. I mean, we've seen radical change in our economy right now, but we're going to see even more radical changes before this year is up. You know, 2020 is a year unlike anything we have experienced in a long time. Some folks are looking back to the 60s, those who are of us who are old enough to remember what things were like back then. And we're seeing a return to that type of energy. There is planetary energy in place right now, and it is affecting everyone all over the globe, but particularly it's affecting us here in America. So we've seen someone in Central Park have the police called on them. We've seen somebody basically choked to death with a knee on the neck. We've seen somebody jogging and murdered. We're seeing all kinds of things. And, you know, in the midst of all of this, we're dealing with a pandemic that seems like it has a tenacious grip on the population of America, as America continues to lead the statistics, or at least what we have been told. So much is going on, and it's really hard to wrap our hands or our minds around it. But somehow, some way, we have to be able to make sense of this, even in the midst of things not making sense, if that makes any sense at all. I just happened to tune into a lot of material online, being plugged into Facebook and reading all the posts that come from both sides of the equation, and then receiving information in my inbox on a daily basis. I mean, I'm literally bombarded with so many videos and memes and opinions, even in my inbox, that I don't really have time to get through them, but I do take notice of many of them, and I just try to make sense of it as best I can. What we're going to do right now, if he is listening, we're going to reach out to our brother Wayne Chandler and ask him to call in on our listener line, and that is 216-578-1490, 216-578-1490. And as we begin the show and we await these calls, I invite you, the listening audience, to collaborate with us and get your opinion in as we wait for folks to join us. You can call us right now at 216-578-1490, 216-578-1490. You got something on your mind, something you want to get off your chest, and we have the time to take your calls. we will absolutely do that. So we will move on to that. And in the meantime, I'm going to send an email message and see if we can't get folks tuned in right now. This is also a pivotal time for businesses. And I think in future shows, we may want to have some conversations with folks who are in the business community right now, because businesses are going out of business because they haven't been able to pay employees, obviously, without having anyone coming through their doors to patronize them, you know. And while you're in this period of inactivity, you know, the gas is still on, the electricity is still on, you're still paying rent if you don't own your space. It really places people in a precarious situation. And they came out with a stimulus package. They passed out money. They weren't able to get it to everyone. You know, then we've got the stimulus checks. You know, some people still haven't received their stimulus checks. So, you know, what do you do when you haven't had any income and it's been, 2 months? What do you do? Then you have the availability of certain goods and products. And I'm just going to go ahead and let the cat out the bag. What we want to talk about on this show today has to deal with the prospect that we will be moving to a digital currency here in America. There are already measures in place where they are taking dollars out of circulation. You're not able to spend money in some businesses. You have to use plastic. You have to use some type of electronic conveyance in order to pay for the things that you have. And there are reasons for that. You know, we are being told that this virus can be spread on the money that we're using and changing hands with. So that's going to be an issue, or they're making it an issue. And for that reason, they're using it as a justification to take cash out of circulation. So if you don't have an ability to use cash, that means you are forced to use some type of electronic means. Everyone doesn't have a bank account. So they are proposing some measures to give everyone access to digital currency. And I believe it was Senator Sherrod Brown here in Ohio who proposed legislation that would provide everyone with digital wallets. They would have to set something up with the banks. I think the way they want to do it is they want to have it so that you don't have to pay for the account. You would just have access to it. Don't really know how that's going to work. But it would be a very, very cumbersome prospect to do that. And it's going to take time and it's going to take money. I have a cousin who lives in Lansing, Michigan, and her name is Teresa. She and her husband just opened up a business right before all of this happened. I think it was around the first of the year that this came up. And, you know, I'm just curious to know from her what it has been like for her to, you know, to continue the prospect of being in business. So, Teresa, I know that you're watching on Facebook Live, and I'd like to invite you to call us at area code 216-578-1490. That's area code 216-578-1490. Our engineer, Tristan Sanchez, will put you through. Once again, if you didn't write it down, it's 216-578-1490, 216-578-1490. We also have a number of folks who are watching us on Facebook Live. We have a good friend and colleague of mine who's very astute in business matters. Her name is Simi Marie Davis, and she is the proprietor of Seven Streams Consulting. So I have another show on another radio station, and we will be airing that interview sometime in the very near future. But I'd like to invite Simi Davis to give us a call. And we also have on the line Stephen E. Boyd. So, Tristan, why don't we patch Stephen Boyd into the show, and we can have a conversation with him. I want to give credit and props to Stephen E. Boyd at this moment, because Stephen has been dealing with a lot of things in his personal life. And in the midst of all of this, he's been a very staunch supporter of 360 Info Network. He is one of the primary reasons that we have this show on the air right now. And I think he deserves the credit. I know he really wouldn't want me to say all of that, but you know, I have to give credit where credit is due, and commend him for, you know, the way he has stepped up to make sure that we continue to be on the air. So, Stephen, are you with us?
I'm with you, Vince. How are you this morning, sir?
I'm doing great, and I'm really glad to hear your voice, and glad to have you on the air right now. We're waiting for Wayne to call us, but I just want to get your perspective right now. What are your thoughts about what we're dealing with right now in terms of the response to the murder that occurred in Minnesota?
You know, I'm really amazed at the amount of things that are going on this day and time. And it just so happens, Vince, you know, I had been a guest on radio in Minneapolis, Minnesota for probably the last 3 or 4 months. Some of the folks there have been listening to us, too, for some time here in Cleveland with this radio show. And so to answer your question in a succinct sort of way, it's just another sign that we have right now that lets us know the time for change is upon us right now on every single front. Personally, I've made the decision not to look at the video of Brother George. I've made that decision, and I've also made the decision, Vince, that I'm done marching. Mm-hmm. The last march that I involved myself in involved about 10 of us on Public Square in Ohio, and it had to do with 137 shots
right. That
were fired at two people, 41 of which hit those people. And two people who were being followed by 52 police cars right here in the city of Cleveland. The very next day, there were 9 or 10 of us that marched on Public Square and called for a federal investigation. And the picture of it was on the front page of the Final Call newspaper. The time for marching and all of that, it's got to end at some point. The time for being appalled about this stuff, it needs to end. So, you know, we should have leadership at this point that is looking at how can we change what we are doing?
Yes.
Because what we've been doing just doesn't work.
Okay. I fully agree with you, and I'm joining you in not viewing the video, because you've seen it once, you've seen it too many times. We have on the line with us right now Brother Wayne B. Chandler, and he's an author, an inspirational speaker. He's a practitioner and a healer, and he is the author of Ancient Future, the Teachings and Prophetic Wisdom of the Seven Hermetic Laws of Ancient Egypt. Welcome to 360 Info Network, Wayne Chandler.
It's good to be here. This is my second home, man.
Okay. All right. Well, you know, Wayne, it is such a privilege and a pleasure, you know, to have you on the air. And you know, we use that term local too loosely, because actually we're all global. I know you travel the world. I travel the world. We just happen to touch base here, but we can be anywhere at any time. So I celebrate the fact that you live here, but I just want to make it known that you are a person of international significance. We invited you on the air today to talk about something that is extremely important. And I also want to acknowledge the fact that Teresa is on the air, and she's on the line, and I want to have her hang on. Perhaps we will be able to have a conversation with her towards the end of the show. But what we're talking about is something that will affect her directly as well as the rest of us. And we want to talk about the upcoming changes in the economy as we think about, you know, the possibility of us not being able to use money. But in our conversation the other day, you also talked about some planetary influences that I alluded to at the top of the show. There are several planets in retrograde right now, and this may not mean anything to many of us, but I was hoping that you could put it into perspective and let our listening audience know what that means and how it is affecting us on a personal level.
In general, without going too deep into specifics, when you deal with retrograde energy, it really is asking you to take a step back, somewhat immobilize yourself, become introspective, begin to look at what you need to take care of, what needs to be addressed in your life, and bring it to completion. And with the number of retrogrades that we're working with right now, as well as other types of celestial configurations, you know, eclipses and such that are coming in to play in June. June is going to be a very, very intense month. And the latter part of June is a configuration that is dealing with Venus, which is going to waylay the financial markets. And it's going to be very, very telling, because you look at what we're going through right now with respect to the coronavirus and the drama, you know, that has been created around that. And when I looked at this whole thing, to me, it had three legs. The first leg is the leg that we're operating in right now. The second leg is going to be the financial piece. And the financial piece, there was an MIT biologist, and his statement was, he says, the fear-mongering on coronavirus will go down as the biggest fraud to manipulate the global economies. And he's so on point with that. But that's not something we're so distracted with this that we don't really have the insight and foresight to see that 80% of this is concocted. You have a United Nations chief who warned, this was a quote from him. He says, authoritarians are weaponizing the pandemic to subvert human rights. The Washington Times, the newspaper out of Washington, D.C., the competition to the Washington Post, says the coronavirus hype is the biggest political hoax in history. So that's what we're working with. And so when you begin looking at these types of headliners, you have to ask yourself, if this is the case, then what is behind all of this? What is the purpose? And so when you look and remove the veil to look behind the curtain to see exactly what that purpose is the manipulation of the financial systems of the world and the crashing, the financial, the economic reset that is going to take place in the next few months and what that is going to create. So right now, the first thing that's taking place that they're talking about is that cash money is dirty. And this feeds into just their intention of using the coronavirus, because what they're saying is that coronavirus attaches itself as a contaminant to paper money. And as paper money moves from hand to hand, the virus spreads from person to person. And in doing that, they need to completely obliterate, annihilate, stop the usage of cash currency in every shape, form, and fashion. So I've talked to individuals, one brother, you know, who has been on the show, Dr. Brown, and he was telling me that he was in the vitamin shop the other day and went up, got up to the cashier, reached in his pocket, pulled out cash to pay for the supplements that he had picked up, and the cashier refused to take the money and told him that we no longer accept cash. Since that time, I've talked to several people here locally as well as California and Washington, D.C., who are telling me the exact same story, that many merchant markets are no longer accepting cash currency.
Okay, so on that point, let's talk about what that means to everyday people, the fact that they may not be able to use currency to pay for things that they need.
Well, you have to look at, in terms of how I see this playing out, I believe it's going to impact the black community way more substantially than other communities, because I believe that we use cash from day to day for various reasons, you know, credit challenges, not having, you know, fluid cash, you know, in our checking accounts that we can really depend on to have a debit card. But I believe that that's going to impact black communities far more substantially than others. So if you remove our usage of cash, money that we use on a daily basis, it's going to create something that's going to be close to financial pandemonium.
And the underlying aspect of this, at least from my perspective, is that there is going to be, or there is an attempt, and they're facilitating a means of having more control of the money supply, but not just that, more control over the lives of people in such a way that it will disable the functionality of people within an economic system. So it seems as though we're seeing the demise of this system versus it being built up. You know, we had a conversation, basically a briefing for this interview, and you know, the whole idea of inflation came up. And when we look at the stimulus packages that have been proposed and rolled out, what we're seeing is an infusion of cash into the American economic system. Talk about the implications of printing all this money and putting it into circulation right now.
The more the Fed does that, of course, the more it devalues the dollar. I mean, the dollar is worthless. I mean, that's just, you know, but it's amazing to me how we continue, even, you know, the Wall Street, pundits and financial mongers, you know, it's amazing to me the game that is continuously played, and it's all about really understanding the game, because they all know that it's pretty much hot air. It's all a fraudulent charade that is put up there, you know, to make us believe that there's some degree of financial stability, either in the market or in America as a whole, and our dealings abroad, because the market began to have a downward spiral latter part of January, going into February. It dropped by 30%. Now, at that particular point, its drop was because of the innate instability that the market has been carrying. The VIX, the volatility index, is registering massive fear in the market. There's no trust in terms of the direction that the market is taking. People are pulling their money out of stocks. The market begins to crash. The Fed sees this and immediately begins printing trillions of dollars that they dump directly into the market. And in dumping those trillions of dollars into the market, they create the illusion that the market has now become restabilized. And people buy that. Mm-hmm. They believe that. They believe that even though the market was right on the verge, the precipice of going off the deep end into a financial, you know, downward spiral, and the Fed steps in with this monopoly money, because the money that we have is worth nothing. The Fed steps in with this monopoly money to boost the appearance of stability in the markets, and everybody believes that. Everybody goes for that. And they don't take into consideration that right now in America, I mean, the job situation here is at its worst since the Great Depression. You have 20.5 million jobs, you know, that are gone. Unemployment is like 14.7%, which is the worst that it's been since the Great Depression. We haven't seen numbers like that since the Great Depression. So the whole blowing up and inflating prosperity in the market means nothing when you look at the reality of where the country is right now. I mean, in terms of just, and those are just jobs going across the board, but we're not even talking about the businesses that have gone under during this time of the corona drama. So what has happened in America, what has allowed the dollar to reign supreme, is that the dollar has been the dominant world reserve currency. And being the dominant world reserve currency, that means that all other countries are using the dollar for commercial trade, export, and merchant marketing on an international basis. Everybody gets paid in U.S. dollars. When you have the French Open, the Australian Open, all of those tennis players, they don't get paid in the currency of the country that tennis match is representing. They get paid in U.S. dollars. And that's the power that the dollar has had for decades now as being the world reserve currency. So when you have all of a sudden, and this is how I see things manifesting. So you have a statement that's made that the United States is about to move away from using cash money. Now you have to look at all of the things that function from a foundational platform of cash money. You're looking at banks. You're looking at people's retirement, 401s, IRAs. You're looking at pensions. You're looking at Social Security. You're looking at a lot of other dynamics that feed into the usage of cash and have cash as their base platform that gives them authenticity. Now, if you remove cash, all of those different programs become null and void. Then you're looking at serious, serious inflammatory conditions, hyperinflammatory conditions leading to hyperinflation. You're looking at the dollar being removed as the world reserve currency. And if the dollar is removed as the world reserve currency, the game ends. And at that particular point in time, we're looking at a serious, serious move into a very financially depressive state. It was Ron Paul. Now, Ron Paul was one of the former presidential candidates. But Ron Paul has served 22 terms as a congressman. Ron Paul states that the whole perfect storm, as he calls it, of financial upheaval that America is moving into or has moved into is going to hit in the next few months. And when it does, it's going to create a depression, a financial depression in this country that the likes of the world has never seen.
Okay, let me interrupt right now and just let everyone that's listening know that you're listening to 360 Info Network with Vince Robinson and our very special guest, Wayne B. Chandler. We're talking about some upcoming changes in the financial system, the economic system here in the United States. And I can't underscore or overstate the fact that what we're dealing with right now is an illusion. You know, paper money has no value. It's not backed by anything. You know, we talk about it being fiat currency right now. So the fact that they're pumping all this money into our system, you know, there's going to be hyperinflation, as you indicated. And what that means is that at some point in the future, you may have to pay as much as $40 for a loaf of bread just because the prices have increased. I also want to let everyone know that I have posted a link to Zoom. So at noon, we're going to switch over to Zoom and we're going to resume this conversation on that platform. It will enable some of you to come in and actually have conversation with us and ask the questions. My cousin, Teresa Sheffy Smith, who is tuning in from Lansing, Michigan, we hopefully will be able to get her on at that time. And anyone else who is watching us on Facebook right now, you can actually participate in the conversation and get some clarity on some of the things that we're talking about. We really don't have time within the next 19 minutes to delve deeply into the subject as we need to. So I just want to let you know that we can exercise an opportunity to dig in deep. We'll get that happening. I want to bring our brother Steve Boyd into the conversation at this point and just talk about business, you know, the business of this show and business in general, because among other things, Steve is a businessman, and just get your perspective on your perception of these changes and how they will affect how we do business.
Vince, greetings, of course, to my esteemed friend, Brother Wayne Chandler. We have got to understand that we're in a time of change right now from all perspectives, and it's wise for us to heed the call and heed the information that Wayne has just shared and that we've been sharing. since the very beginning, since Hamtonio's very beginnings on this show, with our community, with trends and ideas that help us live a stronger life, that help our black community live a stronger economic life. Nothing's any different as we move forward into the future. So we wanted to bring on change, and we are bringing on change. We do have, as we've spoken to on several occasions, a website that offers you an opportunity to take a look at the show from behind the scenes, 360 Info, www.360infonetwork.com. But we're going to offer a stronger advertising opportunity for our listeners out here. And you'd have to be Ray Charles not to know that the show that precedes us brings a listenership of somewhere in the neighborhood of 4,000 to 5,000 people, which we maintain throughout. Don't let the Facebook user number mean anything to you. It really doesn't mean much with regard to how many people are listening to this show. So, very practically, if you are a black business person, since the very beginnings of this show, Hamtonio attempted to offer to our black community businesses an opportunity to be heard. This is the most qualitative forum for that to happen, and it was then, and it still is right now, 15 years later. So we're going to be offering an advertising opportunity. You'll be able to see and see more about it on our website during this week. You may call me at 216-526-1297. And start advertising your business, start advertising your community group on this show. Let's make this show the powerful beacon that it can be. And we're going to expand. We're going to expand some things. We're going to build on what it is that Hamtonio has done. We're going to continue to keep all parties involved with this show, Hamtonio, et cetera, so that we can continue to bring the kind of quality that we have been bringing for 15 years of listeners, 15 years of top quality national and local people of note.
Okay.
Wayne Chandler certainly is at the top shelf of that list of
Absolutely.
People with subject matter that we need to be dealing with. So that basically is some information I want us to be aware of in this day. It's important. Let's start advertising on this show. You can talk to me about just how to do it, and let's see a change beginning next week. Let's do some things to make this show really function.
Okay. Since we brought up business, I want to bring in my cousin Teresa Sheffy Smith. Teresa is a businesswoman. She just, I believe, has become Dr. Smith. I know I watch her on Facebook, and I know that she's recently completed a course of study and is navigating a new course of life with that, in addition to being a business owner. So let's bring Teresa Sheffy Smith into the conversation and talk to her about how the economic shutdown has affected what she is doing and whether or not she's had any success in obtaining government aid. Teresa, welcome to 360 Info Network. Okay, I'm not sure that she is with us right now, so we're gonna put that on pause and bring our brother Wayne back into the conversation. Brother Wayne, we talked the other day about the impact of inflation and how the economy is going to change, and I'm just imagining, you know, or just thinking about, you know, where I live. You know, I'll just put it out there. I live in Glenville. I live in the hood. You know, I hear the sirens. I hear the gunshots. You know, every once in a while, I might need to go to a local store. And when I go to stores in my neighborhood, most of the time, what I see is cash transactions. And I just know that, you know, when people lose their ability to do that transaction with cash, then it's going to present some problems for folks who don't have access to the technology. You know, a lot of folks aren't on the internet. You know, they don't have Wi-Fi in their homes. And in order to access it, they go to the library. But the libraries have been closed. and they're discouraging people from coming in. You know, they're having you place an order for the book that you want, and then you drive up to the library and somebody hands it to you through a window or out the door. You know, what do you see as the impact on everyday people and communities like Glenville and Lee Harvard, where you are, I believe, and other neighborhoods in the cities and across the country?
It's going to be devastating. Pure devastation. I mean, there's no better way or more accurate way to express that. I mean, it's going to be devastating, because what they want to do by saying that paper money is dirty, they want to go into digital currency. And going into digital currency, not even, you know, just, you know, black communities, but just general communities across the board in America know very little to nothing about digital currency. And so when that shift begins to take place, and it is going to take place, I mean, this is something that began back in 2017 with an address that Christine Lagarde, who was then head of the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, stated in an address called Winds of Change, that the world is going to go digital because every other aspect of the planet is moving along a digital timeline. It only makes sense for money to move along that same timeline. And so when that begins to take place, people are going to be completely and totally dumbfounded because they have not been exposed to that body of information to even know how to proceed and navigate that environment. They have no clue. I mean, right now, the three things that loom most prominently to me: gold, silver, and cryptocurrency. There are cryptocurrencies that are functional right now that will provide financial stability, and there are cryptocurrencies you can invest in, which are going to become more prominent in the immediate future. But that right now, getting into them, you pay virtually nothing. The investment is literally nothing compared to what it's going to be once these cryptocurrencies really explode in value. Right now, silver is like $17 an ounce. We don't stop and think about alternatives. We don't stop and consider the options that we have. And it's about how we perceive our reality. We would rather go to the convenience store or the gas station and get lottery tickets for 15 to 20 years every day, dropping as much as $10 to $20 on tickets, and not once consider, well, maybe I need to learn something about stock and make an investment in the stock market and make money that way. Because one in 45 million will win something in terms of money from a lottery ticket. Most people drop money like that.
I'm on the radio, Jackie.
For the whole duration of their life, and they never walk away with anything. That much money that they have wasted could easily be put into investments of some form or fashion that will give them a yield that they can use constructively to build some kind of financial future.
So what you're talking about, and excuse the interruption, but I have to move things forward, and I just want to put things into perspective, because what you just said is it's profound. You know, when you have spent a lifetime investing in a lottery that does not guarantee you any kind of return, it's just based on the concept of luck. And you might be that lucky person who wins the multi-million-dollar lottery, or you play the three number or the four number or whatever, and you do that, and you know every once in a while you might get $40 or $50 or $500. But if you took all the money that you invested over a 20-year period of time and you just did something as simple as buying Bitcoin, which started out as 1 cent or 2 cent per coin, and then ended up being where it is now, around 10,000, and now has the potential to go up to a value of as much as $1 million in the near future. You will have wasted an opportunity. But we don't have education that gives us what we need to know that we should be making investments and not just putting money into an account somewhere. You know, you have a savings account, and with interest rates being what they are right now, they're talking about the possibility of going into negative interest rates, which really means that you will be paying somebody to have your money. So we're going to dive into that in the second hour of the show when we move over to the Zoom platform. But I just wanted to point that out. I also want to let everyone know that we're recording our program now so that we can post podcasts. If you go to the 360 Info Network page on Facebook, you can actually access the podcast. Now, also post the podcast to my page, Vince Robinson, on Facebook. So if you missed the show, if you weren't able to tune in on any Saturday morning, now you can go to YouTube, and now you can get the benefit of the expertise that comes from brothers like Wayne and our dear friend, Dr. James Brown, and some of the other scholars that that grace the airwaves on 360 Info Network. I want to give my cousin Teresa another chance to get in before we get off the air. It's 11:54. We've got about 5 minutes before we end the show. So, Teresa Sheffy-Smith, are you with us on 360 Info Network?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you perfectly. I just wanted to get your perspective, since you are on the air with us, what your experience has been with the shutdown, how it has affected your business.
Orlando, I need you to fix your phone.
Okay. So did you get the question?
Dang it.
All right. Did you hear the question? I just wanted to get some perspective from you on how the shutdown has affected your business, and if you've been able to secure any relief or aid from the government.
Is that 90?
Okay, apparently it seems as though we're having some technical difficulties.
I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, that whole dynamic is fascinating in itself, mm-hmm. because we're looking at various businesses that have like gone under. I mean, that are teetering, you know, that have become household words, like Hertz, you know, Rent-A-Car, JCPenney. You know, they're going bankrupt right now. You have farmers that are slaughtering livestock, you know, plowing under vegetables, you know, removing and breaking up millions of eggs because they just don't have the gateway to really move their product into the various places any longer. You know, so the amount of devastation to like businesses, large and small, is overwhelming. And they want us to believe in some form or fashion that we're going to bounce back from this.
Right. But it seems as though we're headed towards another shutdown at some point during this year. At least that's what some of the pundits are predicting.
No question.
And why do you think that would happen?
It's going to be because of the financial piece. you know, the economics. You can't move without having any kind of a currency as gas to move you. You become stagnant and your country becomes totally immobilized. And that's what we're looking at right now. I mean, basically, that's what hyperinflation is. When you look at Argentina, when you look at Venezuela, when you look at Greece and you know, a lot of the other countries, you know, that have been subjected to this kind of financial, you know, paralysis, it didn't fare well for them at all. Everything closed, and we don't stop and think that this could ever happen to us. That's the thing. The government has done such a great job on instilling this perspective of immense longevity, financial stability, that we don't think that we could ever succumb to those types of upheavals.
Okay. All right. At this point, I want to invite you all to go to the 360 Info Network Facebook page, or you can go to my page where I posted the links to our Zoom meeting, and
time to wrap up.
And you can and join us on that platform as we wind this show down. We have been talking to our brother Wayne B. Chandler, the author of Ancient Future, and we've been talking about the economic situation here in America. It's about to take a drastic turn for the worst, and we want to inform you of things that you can do to prepare yourself for what is to come. It doesn't have to be a total loss for everyone. There are some of us who have the resources who can do some things to ensure our economic survival and stability in the midst of all the chaos and confusion, because, you know, there are some who will benefit and there are a lot who will lose. So we want right. you to be in a position to win as opposed to being in a position to lose. So once you click on the link, I will bring you into the meeting. I invite Brother Wayne to do the same thing. Thanks, Steve, for contributing to the show. And
definitely.
Let's continue this conversation. In the meantime, we thank our engineer, Tristan Sanchez, for the fine job that he does engineering our program. And we thank those of you who are listening on the air on the radio for joining us, and also those who are on Facebook Live. We had a nice audience on, and we hope that you will migrate over to the Zoom platform. That being said, know yourself, love yourself, be yourself, and make it a great day, Cleveland. Peace.
Great show, Vince.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. And we'll talk next week.
You got it. Sorry once again for the delay at the beginning.
Oh, that's okay. I understand what happened. And I know Flash, so it's all good.